who's joining us on Facebook Live right now, and good afternoon or evening if you're watching at another time. And there are some of us here at Cornerstone this morning and grateful to be together and have come to rejoice and to worship and to even now hear from God through His Word. This morning's message is a simple one, probably the absolutely simple and yet significant and sincere. And the message this morning, which resonates with the season in which we find ourselves as we anticipate celebrating again the arrival of Christ on earth. He's already come, He's already lived, He's already died, He's already been buried, He's already resurrected, He's already ascended. That happened about 2,000 years ago, depending on 2,000 years. But we celebrate it every year because it's the beginning of the gospel. The incarnation of Jesus Christ. We're going to again acknowledge this morning. God handpicked this little girl named Mary to be the virgin spoken of in Isaiah chapter 7. And God knows what He's doing. And so, with that in mind, we're going to look at this message. Emanuel, God with us. The subtitle will be Celebrating the Simplicity and Reality and Blessings and Beauty of God's Presence. God's presence in all that He's made, and God's presence by His Spirit in a very personal way in each of our lives. I was thinking again about the difference between being prepared and not being prepared. And not being prepared when it comes to some things is no big deal, really. Some things it's no big deal if you're not really totally prepared. But for other things, not being prepared is a big deal. In fact, it could be such a big deal that it would be a big deal between life and death if you're not prepared for what is ahead and what needs to happen. If you intend to go hiking and camping in the desert for a week, you probably shouldn't just decide to do that and go on a whim and then walk out the door with just whatever clothes you're wearing, whatever happens to be in the car as you drive away. That's no way to go spend a week in the desert. You might want to have some water, on hand, just things to do with the elements, any critters that might want to hurt you or all that stuff. Being prepared truly can be the difference between life and death. And one of the wisest things a person can do is have a competent and caring companion when heading into uncharted territory. It's in Ecclesiastes, it's often spoken of weddings, that two are better than one. And then a cord of three strands is not easily broken. That you're usually better off with someone with you, especially if you're heading into the unknown or into danger. Which, the unknown is what all of us are heading into these days in brand new ways, right? And so as we can consider this and understand, if ever there was a story for that, if ever there was a story that was the case, where that was the case and that was the need, it is, again, each one of us in our lives and in the time in which we live, we need someone to travel with us. Not just someone in a human way, but certainly God Himself. Jesus would be the one to be your guide. He is the only one who can lead you in every good way. Only He can heal, love, and forgive the way you need to be healed and loved and forgiven. And he can lead you into what is unknown to you because it's totally known to Him. It inhabits eternity. When you saw the typeset that made the word forgiven from that verse, it says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." And four is in huge letters, and then the very last word is given, and then in regular sized letters, as is laid out on this meme, it's the verse, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." And you see four given. And that's who He is, and that's what He's done. He came to forgive us, to love us, to heal us, to guide us. And this great song, I'll read this to set it up, the words from Isaiah chapter 7 and Romans chapter 8, Emmanuel, it means, in the Hebrew, it means God with us, present among us, not So this is it quite simply. A sign, and this is what Jesus says, a sign will be given. A virgin will conceive, a human baby bearing undiminished deity. The glory of the nations, a light for all to see, the hope for all who will embrace his warm reality. Emmanuel, our God is with us. And if God is with us, who could stand against us? Our God is with us. Emmanuel. For those who live in the shadow of death, a glorious light has dawned. For all those who stumble in the darkness, behold, your light has come. And then this is where the invitation is issued, and then the response is ours. So what will be your answer? Or will you hear the call of him who did not spare his son, but gave him for us all? On earth, there is no power, there is no depth or height that could ever separate us from the love of God in Christ. That's straight from Romans chapter 8, which very much connects to and is actually tethered to the promise of a virgin conceiving. Emmanuel, our God is with us, and if God is with us, who can stand against us? Our God is with us, Emmanuel. And that passage in Isaiah, it is meant to be a sign. How many times prior to Mary conceiving without physical intercourse, and how many times after Mary conceiving without physical intercourse has a woman conceived? None. The virgin birth is meant to be a sign, and a sign is meant to give direction, and a sign is meant to grab attention, and a sign is meant to speak to us. And we are called to hear this. So this morning's message again is that God is with us. And you've probably heard that phrase many times. And of course, the prayer this morning is that you will hear it as though it was the first time. So celebrating the simplicity and reality and the blessings and the beauty of God's presence with us, God's presence among us. Here's the theme for this morning's message. God became one of us to rescue, redeem, and be with all of us. That's his heart's desire. That's what people today would say, that's the end game. He didn't just come to make an appearance. He came to pull off a rescue. And those are two different things. He didn't just show up and wave and say, "Hi, I'm God. Best of luck." No, no, no. He came and he lived among us as God to show us what life and love is really all about. So again, that's the theme. Here's the application. What to do with what you hear. Do not allow anyone or anything to steal this gift of God's grace from you. The awareness of the gift that God is in his very real presence in our lives. Mentioned earlier a brother who was here yesterday, and I remember him posting this cartoon a while ago, one panel cartoon, and what it was like, it appeared to be like a bully or like a tyrant standing in the pulpit, behind the pulpit, on a huge board. I mean, just a huge board, and the pulpit he's standing behind, and he's ranting and raving at this crowd of people. The pulpit and he are over the cliff, the edge of a cliff, where he's standing, and on the cliff, and on the entire length of that same board is a group of people. And what is the whole point of that? You've got this huge group of people standing on a board that the same guy is suspended over the cliff on, ranting and raving at them. What do they need to do to make him stop? Get off the board. He'll go down. It's a picture of consent. The only power this guy has is the power that you give him through consent. All of you, step off the board. He doesn't need to stick around. Now, whatever the story is behind it, that's another story. But the point being, and that's what I'm saying here, the only way somebody can have a gift that God has given you is if you give them consent and let them take it. And certainly for us as Christians, we need to say, don't do that. The one who has all the power and has all authority is the one who's with us. And so we don't need to give consent to somebody who's been trying to steal that joy, to steal that peace, to steal that promise from God. Don't give consent. carry on together, being carried by God himself in this Advent season of 2020, we find ourselves in a situation that all but forces us to have to consider the truth of this magnificent message. God is with us and for us, in us and among us. We get to say that now on the other side of the cross and the resurrection and the ascension. They couldn't say that in the Old Testament. In a way they never knew, we know now by God's Spirit, God is with us and God is for us and God is in us and God is among us. It was Duke Kwan, he's a pastor in Washington, D.C., who tweeted on November 28th, listen to this, Advent is not 4 weeks of Christmas. It is, rather, a season of hopeful aching and watchful waiting amidst the very conditions, depravity, disease, division, despair, death, that made Christmas necessary at all. Isn't that powerful? That the reason we embrace Advent, because the weeks of Advent leading up to Christmas Day are meant to elicit and stir up and deepen and strengthen the anticipation, to be looking for what God is going to do. Maybe God with us, part of the Christmas story, remain with us always as God intends. As it does, may those around us always know it too. It's a big part of this morning's message. If God is with us and God is for us, and we're around people who don't know him yet, they should begin to experience that reality, that we don't walk alone, that there's somebody who's with us always, who lives inside us in a way we never knew before we were born again of God's Holy Spirit. And so it's that message that has its own meaning that calls us to, we sang earlier here just this morning, to go tell it on the mountain. And go tell it in the marketplace, and go tell it in the workspace, and go tell it at the grocery store, and the gas station, and on the street you live, in the building where you're living. Go tell it, as we talked about last week, not just with your lips, but with your lives. All of us together. So the truth of Emmanuel means, the first thing we'll see this morning, turn with me there to Isaiah chapter 7. Isaiah chapter 7. It's after Psalms and Proverbs. Psalm of Solomon, then it's Isaiah. And Isaiah chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. This is the story of this is the prophecy where God speaks clearly. That is not the correct reference, is it? It's not 13 through 14. It is, where is it? Where it says, yes it is. It's 13 and 14, sorry. I'll be all right. I'm looking right at it, not seeing it. There's its own sermon illustration, isn't it? Isaiah 7, 13 and 14. The first point this morning is this. The truth of Emmanuel, God with us, means his presence, and this works in English, P-R-E-S-E-N-C-E, that his presence with us, not only presence, P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S, physical gifts, given to us matters most. So I'll just read it again. God's presence with us, not any presence given to us, matters most. Underneath that point, it says, having and being with the greatest giver is greater than any earthly gift. There's no gift that anybody can put under a tree. There's no physical gift that anybody can give us that's more important or greater than the gift of God's presence with us. Because all those gifts fade, they lose their whatever they have, and yet his presence is the greatest gift there is. So where this prophecy is given, we see it here in Isaiah chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. Then Isaiah said, hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans when you try the patience of God also? And this is God's response to them trying even his patience. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and call him Emmanuel. And then it goes on to describe his lifestyle. This one. And this one who at that point is coming, we understand to to be the one who is sent by God. He sent him to this world through the womb of a woman. The exact same way every single one of us came into this world through the womb of a woman is the way that God touched down on this planet. The exact same way. The only difference is that the womb of this woman happened to belong to a virgin and who was completely pure physically in that sense, yet pregnant with God's Son, the Holy Spirit, that mystery. But that's the prophecy, that's the promise. Verse 14, the Lord himself will give you a sign. And here's one of the tragedies, and there's a couple of tragedies we'll talk about this morning. One of the tragedies of this is that he told them exactly what the sign would be, and then the sign happened exactly the way he said it would happen. And most people never looked, and aren't even looking today. Never in the history of humanity has a virgin become pregnant. Never. And again, it's meant to be an attention getter and to call people to take a long, hard look at what this is and what this means. And as it's said just about every Christmas, I'm saying it again this Christmas season, as it's said just about every Christmas at some point by me, is that one of the best ways to describe the Christmas story doesn't involve a leg lamp or Santa warning, you'll shoot your eye out, kid. Right? Because most people hear the Christmas story, many people would think of the movie. I'm not talking about the movie with a leg lamp and you shoot your eye out, kid. That's not the Christmas story we're talking about. What we're talking about this morning is the Christmas story, the one concerning Christ, the virgin birth, the Messiah coming to earth. So one way that best describes the real Christmas story is simply promises made, promises kept. A bunch of promises made, a bunch of promises kept. That's one of the best ways to describe the Christmas story. God made a promise and he kept it. He made another promise and he kept it. And again, having been to Israel, looking back, where it talks about the way of the Gentiles, looking over this cliff outside of Jerusalem and seeing the reality of that path and saying upon these people at this very specific time, in this very specific place, in a very specific way, a light is going to dawn. This is long before electricity, right? And they may have been thinking candlelight. They may have been thinking something from the sun or a star or a moon. No, but this was a living light, a human light who was God himself. So, promises made, promises kept. And again, this first passage, and then turn with me to Matthew, that passage in Isaiah 7, promise made, promise kept. And here's where we see it clearly kept. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 24. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 24. We read these words. So back there in Isaiah 7, we hear that a virgin will conceive and give birth to a son. And we'll read 18 through 24. This is the account of Joseph. Put yourself in Joseph's place. He's betrothed to be married, and his betrothed wife is pregnant. Of course, for him, this is very sad news. Because he knew exactly how people get pregnant. And now she's pregnant. We got trouble. And in that context, listen to these verses. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 26 through 25. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. Before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. He loved her, and he wanted to minimize the damage in her life. Put her away quietly. Don't even talk about it, don't make this public. This is a terrible thing she's done. She's committed fornication in his mind. That's not what happened. But after he considered this, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, This is where the dots are connected by God himself in his holy word. Listen to this, verse 22. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. Which prophet? Isaiah, the one we just heard from. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emanuel, which means God with us. So because Joseph was having a very hard time dealing with this news, unable to process it from an earthly point of view, an angel came to him while he slept and spoke to him in a dream. And when he awoke, he knew he had been spoken to by an angel. And here's what he did. When he woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife, but he did not consummate her marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave her the name Jesus. She remained a virgin, even though she was now married to him. They never had intercourse until after Jesus was born. So a virgin gave birth to a son. Who said that was going to happen? Right? And that's the beauty of this. That's the power of this. That's the wonder of this. And so now his presence has come. God has joined us on the planet as one of us, again to rescue all of us. And those two passages, Isaiah 7, 13 and 14, and Matthew 18-24, and especially that 23rd verse, is what Matthew was doing is quoting Isaiah. No doubt about it. That's exactly what was going on here. And then this passage, if you'll turn with me there to Colossians. The book of Colossians that speaks of this. What verse is it? Verses 25-29. When we acknowledge that God's presence is what matters most. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. If you get to that part of it. Right after Philippians. Colossians chapter 1. Verses 25-29. Before I read that, let me say this, that those of us who have lost loved ones to death know that someone's presence with us is more important than any present they ever gave us, right? Those of us who lost a loved one to death know that their presence with us was and remains more important than any gift they may have given us, even if we still have that gift. Although the bittersweet irony is that gift somehow still keeps us connected to them, because we know they gave it, they bought it, they picked it out, they made it, however it happened. But we would rather have them than anything, right? With our loved ones. God's promised presence is one of the distinguishing realities of Christianity. God's promised presence is one of the distinguishing realities of Christianity. Not only is Jesus alive again after having literally died to forgive and free us from our sins, and even the redemption story is connected in that passage in Matthew, because what did the angel say to Joseph? Name him Jesus. Why? He will save his people from their sins. He came to save us, to be our Savior, to deliver us from everything that was keeping us from God. He, Jesus, is with us by the Holy Spirit who lives in us today. So listen to these words from Paul there in Colossians chapter 1. I'm going to look at verses 25-29 in Colossians chapter 1. I have become, we'll start at verse 24 for the context. Now I rejoice in what I am suffering for you. I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's affliction for the sake of his body, which is the church. I have become its servant, the church's servant, by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the Lord's people. To them, God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. He is the one who proclaimed, admonishing, and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. To this end, I strenuously contend with all the energy Christ so powerfully works through me. No. In me. And when Paul says there in verse 27, to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. that the truth of Emmanuel means God's presence with us, not any presence given to us, matters most. We celebrate that as we acknowledge that God is with us and God lives in us. And the second and last part this morning is this. The truth of Emmanuel, God with us, means our lives should be living proof of His loving presence. Our lives should be living proof of His loving presence. If somebody moves in, you know it, right? If you live with somebody, you know they're there. Their presence is undeniable. Or if you have a guest in your home or that kind of thing. If somebody moves in, if somebody comes into your life, you don't need somebody to tell you, did you know somebody's not part of your daily routine? No, you don't need anybody to tell you that. You know that. And talk about being part of your daily routine. When you talk about God moving in, because He lives in us, our lives, and that's the second point, should be living proof of His loving presence. Underneath that, the second point, it says, since He is with us everywhere and always, people around us are around Him too. Have you ever been in a situation where you're with someone, and maybe, you know, you just came across their path, or you guys just reconnected, but you can't remember the name, and then somebody comes up and knows both, who knows you but doesn't know them? And the awkwardness of thinking, I have to introduce someone that I can't even remember their name. That awkward moment, and the point being that when you're with somebody and somebody else comes up with you, the normal thing you'll do is, if they don't know that person too, is what? Make the introduction. What a picture of the way it's supposed to be for us as Christians, because everywhere we go, who is with us? He is. And again, I'm not saying that would just be weird if you walk up to anybody and say, do you know Jesus is with me? I'd like to introduce you to Him. Well, that, there may be a time for that, but that's not the default action here. But the reality is His presence in us. If somebody is with us and His presence is in us and He is with us, they're with Him too, even if they don't know it yet. And that's why it comes back to us in our lives. Should be the living proof of His loving presence. And one of the greatest things, in a winsome, encouraging way that anybody can say to us as Christians, in a way that is positive and inviting, is there's something different about you. And in that context, when it's right, as the Spirit leads the conversation, of course, one of the responses would be, there's not just something different about me. There's someone different with me. He rescued me. He lives inside me. He loves you. And those kind of conversations are the best. Matthew 28:20, you can turn there. It's the end of the book of Matthew, the end of what we call the Great Commission. I'll just turn it to read it to make sure I get it straight. Matthew 28:20, yeah, it is the last verse of Matthew 28, where the Great Commission starts in verse 18. All authority is given to me in heaven and on earth, go therefore. And then this 18th verse says, after, you know, teaching them, all the nations, baptizing them, and verse 20 says, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And then we hear these words, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Again, that's His promised presence by Him Himself. Surely I am with you always. We are not always aware of His presence, that's for sure. We may not sense His presence. We may not feel His presence. But we can know, based on the authority of the One who doesn't lie, that He is with us. And we need one of the biggest things, and we may talk about this a little in the next week or the week after before Christmas. One of the biggest things that the Christmas story tells us, the Nativity narratives, is that the repeated message from the angels with Joseph, to Mary, with the shepherds, don't be afraid. Yes, this is new. Yes, this is different. the poster child for I'm yours, God. Whatever you want. Here's my body. That's amazing. Anyway, so in Matthew 28:20, we see, we hear from God's word, Jesus say, I will be with you always. And so his promised presence is to be evident in its impact. But I do want to acknowledge that, and lo, and the King James says, lo, I am with you always. Everywhere you go, I am too. But we need to understand that that is very much connected to us going and making disciples and baptizing and teaching. That it's not just I'm with you always, anywhere, no matter what. That, and when it says, and surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age, that is just the overflow of the reality of you go, you make these disciples, you baptize these followers in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and you teach them to observe whatever I've commanded you. And I am with you always to the end of the age. So, and I'm not saying that we earn his presence, but that we're acutely, I would argue, and I've experienced this over all these years, we're more acutely aware of his presence if we're doing what he's called us to do. Because he's right in the middle of all that. He's inspiring that. He's leading that. He's commanding that. He's calling us to do that. He's giving us the strength we need. And you're aware of him in a fresh way that way. And then another verse that's referenced, just affirming this, that our lives should be living proof of his loving presence. Turn with me to Acts chapter 4. Some of you are familiar with this story. There's some degree of humor to it in the sense of the fact that the Sanhedrin were having a problem with Peter and John in front of them, along with the guy who'd been healed, which kind of silences any argument that this miracle didn't happen. This lame beggar. But in chapter 4, verse 13, we read these words. So they've been on trial, they've accused them, and then Peter starts quoting the Old Testament again, talks about the cornerstone. Powerful, if you read here in Acts 4:12, a lot of people quote that verse in sharing the gospel. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. That's in the context of them being on trial, and he says that. And listen to this 14th verse. So, I just heard him talk. The 13th verse. When they, the Sanhedrin, who basically were holding their life in their hands, they could sentence them, they could do whatever they wanted. Verse 13. When they saw the courage of Peter and John, and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished. And let that word rattle. They were astonished, dumbfounded, totally surprised, blown out of the water. Their socks were knocked off, however you want to say it. This was staggering to them. Uneducated, ordinary men. They were astonished, and they took note that these men had what? Been with Jesus. Because Jesus had been with them. And if you look back, what they're in trouble for is what happened in Acts chapter 3, with that, where, you know, Peter, this guy's begging at the gate, and Peter says, silver and gold have I none, but what I have, I give in the name of Jesus, rise and walk. And this guy who'd been lame his whole life stood up and walked. You don't think that news spread? You don't think that got the attention of the people right there and then? Everybody knew this guy was lame. He couldn't walk. And he supernaturally, instantly, and completely healed. And the Sanhedrin, aren't you happy about this? Because they're the religious power workers of the day. They don't have that power. And then again, what's funny, if you look in verse 14, this is where it's kind of humorous. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing there with him, there was nothing they could say. Like, that's the whole point. This guy had never walked, and now he's standing next to them, and he walked in, and he's going to walk out. And Peter and John say, it is Jesus who did this. We didn't do this. It is Jesus who did this. Why? Because Jesus was with them. As they were, I'm sure they weren't expecting it that day, and probably up to the moment when that situation presented itself, they were not thinking, I bet you somebody who couldn't walk is going to walk today. But then it happened. And an affirmation again of the how powerful and profound it is that when God has his way, it's undeniable. And the people who had the ability to sit in judgment over Peter and John had nothing to say because they knew this guy was healed. And Peter and John gave the glory to God. They did not heal him. God healed him, that's for sure, because God was with them. Living proof of God's love and presence. And then we'll conclude this morning with this passage there in Romans chapter 8. Just move one book over from the book of Acts to the book of Romans. And then it's Romans chapter 8. For the sake of time, I will not read the entire passage, but I command you to read Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. It is a crescendo in the scripture of celebration and declaration and affirmation that helps us as believers understand from start to finish, from before the start to after the finish, from and in the middle of every moment of our lives, God is the victor. And we are his. And it is okay and it will be okay because we're his. Things won't always go okay, but it is going to be okay because God is God. We're more than conquerors, this passage speaks of. So I'm just going to read the first verse and the last two verses in that passage. Romans 8, 31 and then 38 and 39. But I encourage you to read the entire passage, even sometime today. Prior to this, Paul speaks about the juxtaposition of present suffering and future glory. That no story is over until God says it's over. And no suffering is wasted. God redeems everything. Verse 31. What then shall we say in response to all these things? And this is where Paul knew this in a way that is clearly real. If God is for us, who can be against us? And the implication is that the expression of God being for us is that God is with us. Who can be against us? And then in the last two verses there, verses 38 and 39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, that's a pretty sweeping statement. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation. That's the ultimate summing it all up statement. Anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing, no thing can ever accomplish that. Even at the very beginning, to the totally sweeping stroke at the beginning there in verse 38, neither death nor life. Those are the bookends of everything we know. On this side of the grave, neither death nor life. Nothing. And then he goes on to continue to make the point and say in its conclusion, nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And again, for the sake of making the point this morning, the expression of the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord is affirmed and even amplified by God's ongoing presence with us. It's because he loves us that we don't need to be afraid. And again, the chorus of the song that I shared at the beginning, let me end with that. Emmanuel, our God is with us. And if God is with us, who could stand against us? Our God is with us, Emmanuel. Brother, sister in Christ, no matter what the future holds, he is going to hold us through it. He will carry us. He will guide us. He will direct us. He will love us. He will lead us. We may feel clueless. We may be afraid. We may not know where to go or what to do. But if we, in our can't trust the one who has all authority in heaven and on earth? You don't think you can trust him? He has authority over everything, including death and demons, and disease and darkness, and everything that will be no more one day. That right now, God has all authority over it all, and all the power and all the knowledge. End with this, just as a thought. I was going to bring a radio, but I didn't, because now there's so many ways to listen to receive information. And many, 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 many people today are doing what was never done before in streaming information over the internet from even local news or radio stations. But back in the day, if you can remember back to before the internet, some of us are old enough to be able to do that. That all you had, if you had a TV, was an antenna. There was no cable, there was no Wi-Fi or Bluetooth or LGET, whatever the thing is, through the air. It was either a TV with an antenna or a radio with an antenna. And it's the antenna that is the illustration I want to end with. That God's presence, the awareness of God's presence is like the functioning of an old-fashioned radio. Back in the day, and even with the broadcast TV, you can still get broadcast TV through the air to this very day, which is cool. Antennas still work. They're different than they used to be. You know, around here, tin foil. Well, at least it doesn't have to be that way anymore. And that picture of the presence is always there. If I had my radio, I could turn it on and dial it to any local radio station. And what's called the receiver must tune in. Used to be on the analog where you get closer to the station and you try to find the clear signal and then fade out. Now it's all digital. But still, if you don't set the receiver to what is being sent to the tuner in order for it to be experienced, you'll never hear a thing. In fact, right now, some of us know that, well, this new radio station in Mount Barton, 9149, I've been there a couple times. Right now, if you get really quiet, listen to me, can you hear the radio station? Don't tell me you can, because then we have a problem. Of course you can't. Why? Because you don't have the equipment to tune into it by yourself. But you get your radio with an antenna, you can pick it up. You can listen to it, you can enjoy it. That is an expression of what this is. Until you get the antenna, you can't get the station. Until you become God's child, you can't walk in the awareness of His presence. But He has promised never to leave you or forsake you. He's promised to be with you to the very end of time. And it all started with the announcement way back there in Isaiah that this virgin is going to become pregnant. That the Word of God is going to be compressed in a human baby and be born of a human mother and have to learn how to speak. The Word of God Here's the making it real questions. In what ways does your life affirm or deny this reality being that God's presence with us matters most? Not the presence we get, but his presence with us. In what way does your life affirm or deny that? And the second question, I'm not asking that to make you feel bad about anything, just to really wrestle with, am I walking in this? And then the second question is, if someone charged us with Jesus being with us, what would the evidence be? If someone put us on trial like Peter and John, I don't know that I can point to anybody that I can say was instantly healed after I prayed for them or something, but there's some evidence of God's presence in each of our lives, right? And hopefully those around us will be able to say, oh, this is how I know he or she is a Christian. Let me tell you. This is how I've seen Christ getting through their life. And that's the way it should be. And I said earlier, here is the action step. If you're a Christian, keep telling yourself, God is with me. God is with me. And then just let that take you where it will take you. Because it probably would have to be something like, God is for me. God is for me. I don't need to be afraid. I don't need to be afraid. God is with me. By his grace, I can do this. By God's grace, I can do this. Whatever it is, because he's with me. He's able. More than able. And so again, with you, I want to celebrate that this Christmas season, beyond Black Friday week now, or Cyber Monday, or, you know, giving and receiving of gifts as an expression of love, that's a good thing. But there won't be any ultimate satisfaction in those gifts. The ultimate satisfaction is in the awareness of God's presence himself with us. And that's what I hope becomes a bigger part of our story in the days ahead. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we do thank you. We look to you, knowing it's the best thing to do, even right now. We ask you to strengthen us to keep our gaze on and our heart toward Jesus as we continue to navigate life's uncharted territory. Thank you for being the best guide a person could ever have. But through these different days in which we find ourselves, not just as a citizens here in America, but all over the world, we thank you that there is a guide who can lead us, and a God who loves us, and it's one and the same, it's you. And so we thank you and we trust you. We pray for those this morning who find themselves struggling in strange new ways, as well as familiar old ways. For all of us who struggle, deliver us from anything that would mock or minimize us in any way. And we do pray, God, this morning, that our lives will tell your story, and that those around us would hear your story, not just with the words we say, but with the lives we live. And we pray that your story that is full of glory will be seen and heard, and that you will penetrate past the mind to the heart of the matter through the lives, especially those around us,